Well, hello. It is a day that we call Good Friday in the life of the Christian church, and all around the world, faithful disciples are remembering the last moments of the life of Jesus Christ. The sanctuary is much different today than it was last night with all of the bright lights on. No, this is a dark day. And so before the service begins, led by Steve Lirely, and we're going to have there's going to be a video with some of our youth so that they can participate even though they can't be with us here on site. But tomorrow at 5 o'clock in the evening, we're going to have our Holy Saturday service. And I've been working very hard to prepare a message that is equal to the weight of everything that we are wrestling with in a time of waiting. And then on Easter morning at 9 and 10:30, we're going to have great celebrations. And I know some of you very faithfully purchased your Easter lilies, the Easter flowers that are going to make this room so beautiful and smell so wonderful. And after the service, on the church walk there, the driveway of 816 Glen, we're going to have those Easter plants, those Easter flowers, with the name of the person who purchased them. If you want to pick your plant up, please know it'll be there for you. And so I hope you are in a place where you are ready for the weight of this day, the weight, the magnitude of this service. And so why don't we allow ourselves to be called to worship in the following manner.
Please join me in the reading together the call of worship. Slowly, we come together to worship our God on Good Friday. Reluctantly, we hear the story of Jesus' suffering. Bleakly, we follow Jesus to the cross. Humbly, we acknowledge our part in his passion. Deeply, we yearn to understand the depth of his sacrifices. Solemnly, we gather his day to pray and worship together, giving thanks for our Savior, Jesus Christ.
They crucified my Lord, and he never said a mumbling word. They crucified my Lord, and he never said a mumbling word, not a word, not a word, not a word. They nailed him to the tree, and he never said a mumbling word. They nailed him to the tree, and he never said a mumbling word, not a word, not a word, not a word. They pierced him in the side, and he never said a mumbling word. They pierced him in the side, and he never said a mumbling word, not a word, not a word, not
Please join me in prayer. As we gather together today at the foot of the cross, we remember the supreme sacrifice of Jesus, led like a lamb to the slaughter, clothed in humility and grace. He willingly offered himself to death so that we might live forever. We are thankful for his love stretched out on a cruel wooden cross. We dwell on the pain he bore for us and are grateful for the forgiveness that he offers. As we worship and praise now, help us to live in the wonder of this goodness and marvel at his endless grace. Help us feel Christ's love for us. Amen.
John 3:16, God gave his one and only Son so that we might live.
Have you ever been watching a game and been so involved? Have you ever been watching a game and been so invested in one team that you almost can't watch the game at all?
Have you ever sat there watching your team pull ahead and thought that maybe this time things would be different, that this time victory would finally be theirs and by extension yours?
Have you ever sat there and watched as the victory seemed so sure, a moment ago, began to slip away?
Have you ever watched as your team went from leading to tied to trailing, and all you can think is, this is not how this is supposed to go? And that sick feeling in your stomach that this is going to be bad starts to build and build and build, until all you can think about is how much you don't want to watch this, but yet you just can't turn away.
Have you ever held out hope, even a fool's hope, that your team would turn it around and that they would do the miraculous?
Have you ever counted point differentials while you begged the clock to slow down because just maybe your team could snatch victory from the jaws of defeat?
Have you ever sat there when your team lost and felt utterly hopeless?
Have you ever looked at the zeros on the clock and the deficit on the scoreboard and felt like you've been punched in the gut because no matter what else happens, you're wrong to hope, wrong to dream, wrong to look for victory?
Have you ever felt the pain of losing when you thought for sure that this time you were going to win?
If so, then take that feeling and multiply it by 1,000 and stand next to John at the foot of the cross.
Stand there and hold out hope that maybe he isn't really dead until you see his side pierced and the blood and water pour from the wound.
Stand there and watch as the one who you were sure would lead the people of Israel to freedom is nailed to a cross.
Stand there with John and hope for something beyond possible. Hope for the miracle that maybe, just maybe, he would listen to the mockers and save himself like he saved others.
Stand there and listen to his ragged breath as you hold out hope that somehow he will survive this and lead his people to victory and freedom.
Stand there and watch the blood collect in pools around the cross and count the time that he has left before the end.
Take that feeling of loss, that feeling like nothing is ever going to be right again, and multiply it by like a million as you stand there and watch Jesus, the one you called Messiah, the one who healed the sick, raised the dead, and entered the city to shouts of Hosanna, dies right before your eyes.
Stand there and watch as the one that you were sure would save the world is arrested.
Stand there and figure out how you could have gotten all of this so very, very wrong.
When we look at this day through the lens of the resurrection, we can call it good and we can rejoice, for the Savior has come and chosen to die for us.
We can meet here on Good Friday and smile, because we know what this cross means and we know that Easter is coming.
But we must not move too quickly past the cross. You must not look past the pain in order to see the victory. You must not ignore the violence in order to see the empty tomb.
Let us linger for a while on the pain, on the feelings of failure, on that deep pain that comes from losing, from choosing wrong, that pain that comes from being sure that God is going to come through for you and then discovering that he doesn't.
Good Friday reminds us that we live in a world of pain. There is hope because we know that the empty tomb Easter morning is coming, but there is pain and loss and regret and tears. That is where we live. That is what this world is.
We don't want to move too quickly past this day, because it is on this day, this horrible day, that allows us to say with confidence that this world is not our own.
It is this day that allows us to say that even though it looks like we are defeated, we know God has won.
It is this day that we call good, because on this day, God of the universe sent his son to die on a cross to pay a debt that we could never pay.
On this day, Jesus Christ took on himself the penalty for our sins, and we can rejoice and call this day good.
So come, look, remember, and open up your heart as the one who is perfect love gives us his all, so that we may have faith, we may have hope, and we may have life. Amen.
Thank you.
Please listen to these words from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 32, 33, and 34. They were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. They were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. He took the 12 aside again and began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death. Then they will hand him over to the Gentiles. They will mock him and spit upon him and flog him and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise again." May the Lord add his blessings upon this reading of his word. Amen. Will you bow your heads with me in prayer? Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. You are the potter. I am the clay. Amen. Boy, has this been a tough few months. Gather here at the foot of this cross, a place that I am used to going on a regular basis. And I hope it's a place that each of you go on a regular basis. But this is a special Friday, a Friday that we call Good Friday. And there's been a lot of confusion about why we call it a Good Friday. For many of us, we think it's because we know the good that came out of the cross. For some, for years, they believed it's because good was actually a variety of the word God. It was God's Friday. But actually, the word good was easier translated as holy. And so we call it a Holy Friday. In some traditions, they call it a Sacred Friday. Many of us have experienced a lot of loss in the last few months. When this current crisis occurred, I think we took it lightly, and our losses were minimal at best. And, you know, in my case, it's been a while since I've had a haircut. That was the first thing I had to give up. But you know, I'm a big fan of Illinois basketball, and it's been years since I've been able to say that out loud and to cheer for them. I was very excited this year because they had a winning team, and it looked really good. But then March came, and March Madness was canceled. And those of you who know me know I'm also a huge fan of the St. Louis Cardinals and also a St. Louis Blues fan. And one by one, other major sports canceled their seasons or suspended the seasons. And like Pastor Matt, I love to play golf, but golf courses are now closed. I enjoy going to our local high schools to watch activities and sports, but high schools and elementary schools, middle schools are closed. We've lost that. What else has been postponed and suspended during this time? We just received word that Feed My Starving Children is suspended. Our Appalachia service project with the youth has been canceled for this summer. Gatherings that we normally hold here at the church, our classes, our services, our Wednesday night live, our youth and children and family programs, even some of our mission activities have been suspended, or we find ourselves being creative and cautious on how we can continue to have our programs, our services, and our missions. But it has changed drastically. It has come with a loss. Friends and family who have been tragically and drastically hurt or are in line of danger because of their jobs or life conditions. We think, will we ever be able to look at this time as being good? When we think about that, we can imagine what it must have been like to have been the disciples. In the Mark 10 passage, we read and hear that they were on going up to Jerusalem, and things were going their way. Thousands were cheering them on. Jesus was winning. And he even says here in this passage that he was ahead of them. And as a former runner, I know what that means. Things were going great. But then he said something very confusing that had to be confusing to the disciples. When he said, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and scribes." What? "And they will condemn him to death." What? "They will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit upon him and flog him and kill him." What? "And after 3 days he will rise again." I'm sure it had to be very confusing on that road. But the path that Jesus had to follow to arrive at Easter Sunday morning had to include Good Friday. Without Good Friday, Easter doesn't happen. In Luke chapter 9, Jesus said to them all, If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." This had to be very confusing for those who heard those words, because Jesus hadn't yet died on the cross. What must he mean by that very strange phrase, "Take up your cross and follow me"? Crosses were for criminals, bad people, not for each of us. And yet, those are the words he spoke to us. You see, we have an advantage because we can look at Good Friday, this horrible, horrible day, through the lens of Easter. We know what's coming Sunday morning. We know that Jesus will get up and walk out of that cave, out of that tomb. Christ's death was our victory. And so we look at Good Friday, this Holy Friday, this sacred Friday, this day that we think is horrible and dark, through the lens of Easter. As Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians, we proclaim Christ crucified. That's what we preach. And without that crucifixion, it is only through this crucifixion, this horrible, horrible day we call good, that Easter happens. So like our youth shared with us earlier, let's not rush to get through this day. Let's not close our eyes, our ears, our hearts, and our minds and move too quickly past this day. Let's take this day to think through our losses, our hurts, our pains, and call them by name. Each year, Good Friday, it's been a tradition at this church that we come to the cross after our Good Friday service and we take a card and we name our losses, we name our hurts, we name our pains. We take a nail, we take a hammer, and we too, like the soldiers years ago, nail our hurts, our pains, our losses on the tree. So when we place our sins on the cross, we are victorious through Christ's death and resurrection. I'd like to close with a poem. I received an email this past week that said, "Hey, put down your favorite poem and then send it to the person on the list and then ask them to copy and paste and do the same thing. We're going to share poems." And I almost did it, but then I thought, I'd rather share this poem here at this Good Friday service. This poem has been in my office since 1984. It came to me when I was going through some of the roughest times in my life, questions and hurts and pains and losses. It's by Rainer Maria Rilke, and it says, "Be patient toward all that is unsolved in your heart, and try to love the questions themselves. Do not seek the answers which cannot be given you, because you would not be able to live them." And the point is to live everything. Live the questions now. Perhaps you will gradually, without noticing, live along some distant day into the answer. I'm going to share the benediction with you. Following the benediction, there will be a musical offering. And I invite you at home to take a card, a piece of paper, an envelope, something to write with, name your loss, your hurt, your pain. And I want you to put it in a safe place until that day, that Sunday, when we can all gather together here in this church building to worship together again. This cross We will put in the and the narthex out in the lobby. It will be here for you, the hammers and the nails. Bring your card with you that Sunday or any following Sunday and place it upon the cross. And now let us pray. Sisters and brothers, since we are surrounded by all those who have gone before, an enormous cloud of witness, let us drop every extra weight, every sin that clings to us and slackens our pace. Let us run with endurance the long race set before us. Stay focused on Jesus, who designed and perfected our faith. He endured the cross and ignored the shame of that death because he focused on the joy that was set before him. And now he is seated beside God on the throne, a place of honor. In the same way, let us also focus on the race ahead. Go into the days of this week strong in the presence of the Holy Spirit and confident that God goes with you. Amen. During this song, you're invited to focus on the cross. Take that moment and write your losses, your hurts, and pains on a sheet of paper. Fold your paper, place it in a private place. And then when we return to this worship center, place it on the cross. Amen.
Were you there when they pierced him? sun refused to shine. Were you there when the sun refused to shine? The tomb.